Mr. Alessi, are you okay?
You talking to me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Professor Junkin asked me to come out here and play for the school. So that's just doing what he told me to do.
It's beautiful, but I think he might have meant the students.
Ah, I see. Okay.
Maybe we should go inside do a little more?
Sure.
And then we can ride in the seats in the van if you want.
Sounds good.
Great.
Thank you.
Hi, my name's Jeff Jones, director of the Big Blue Band in Mesquite, Texas. A while back, I had a completely original, somewhat borrowed idea to pick up band directors and drive them around in my wife's 2011 Honda Odyssey minivan and have a conversation. This is Maestros and Minivans. Today's guest is the world-famous trombonist Joe Alessi. Mr. Alessi serves on the faculty of the Juilliard School and has been the principal trombone of the New York Philharmonic for more than 30 years.
Thank you for coming and being with us today.
Sure.
It's a huge honor to have the one and only.
I'm just a regular person, just like anybody else. So,
did you know from the beginning that this was what you were destined to do? That what you wanted to do? Did you have?
No. Well, at the beginning, you mean when I was?
When you were a young kid, you first started taking lessons from your dad. Is that correct? Did you first start with?
I didn't really know that it was. That's what I was going to do. I mean, it wasn't until. I switched over to trombone when I was 8 years old, and I didn't know what I really would do with the trombone. I did start listening to jazz trombone and getting really excited about that. And then I started listening to lots of classical records, and I became obsessed with that.
Do you remember where that first started? Do you remember where it first caught your attention?
Leonard Bernstein recordings of Tchaikovsky symphonies. I remember there was one record where it was the Tchaikovsky Six with Bernstein and New York Philharmonic, and they had the whole picture of the orchestra there. Mm-hmm. And I guess because my father knew some of the old Philharmonic players, I would look at that, disc cover and, try to imagine what it would be like to play in an orchestra like that.
Now, you say, and I appreciate your humility, that you're a regular guy, but I don't know a lot of regular guys that started with the New York Philharmonic when they were 26. Is that correct?
25.
25?
Yeah. Well, that's common. That's common for players to start that young. Even younger. I mean, when I was in Philadelphia, I was 20.
I know. Yeah. So, am I correct that you graduated high school early?
Yeah, I got a nice, really nice opportunity to play professionally with a very nice orchestra, San Francisco Ballet Orchestra. And they have some great musicians out there still. And it was always a great orchestra. And, get to play great repertoire. The complete Prokofiev Romeo and Juliet, for those of you who haven't heard that piece, don't just listen to the excerpts, listen to the whole ballet, because there's some of the most beautiful melodies ever written in that ballet. So it's probably some old recordings, and then listening to some Chicago recordings later on, and then just sort of collecting. I think at that point, that's when I got my excerpt books, and for every excerpt book, if I didn't know what the piece was about, let's say if it was, Russian Easter or even some other obscure piece, Borodin Symphony Number 2. Something like that. And if I didn't know anything about it, I would go find a recording of it. And then I'd listen to it. And I wouldn't listen to just find the trombone parts. I would just listen to the whole piece. And I find that that's something that people just don't do.
some of your, maybe not your students today, but you meet students who maybe have pigeonholed themselves just in the excerpts.
My students also.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just people don't want to sit down and listen to a piece and study it. That's just something they don't want to do.
But they need the context.
They need that. They can't just practice the excerpts and know nothing about the piece. And the people who do that, when students go and play auditions and they don't know the piece, you can tell.
Yeah.
They're not listening to the piece as they play the excerpt.
And then from there to Curtis, is that correct?
Yeah. Then I went to Curtis and had just a wonderful schooling there and got to listen to the Philadelphia Orchestra on a weekly basis. I would always go weekly, right? And I don't understand why. I would always find a way to do it, even if I had to pay for a ticket. And I think part of, you know, your education should be, if you have access to a symphony orchestra, and that's what you're going to school for, you know, you really need to go out of your way to hear a symphony orchestra every week. I mean, why should you train for something and not want to hear it, unless you're in the orchestra? You know, it seems to me you want to sit back, dream about being in the orchestra, and listen to how people do their job, watch how they do their job, and watch what the conductor's doing, and just the more you know about orchestras and how they work, and you know, you need to hear the symphony orchestra, and then not, of course, study the repertoire that you're supposed to know by heart. You should be able to, you know, everybody could sing the whole symphony.
What are you looking for as an incredible player, surrounded by other incredible players in that space? What are you looking for?
You have to have somebody up there who gives us a concept. A team leader is what you need. And that's the job of the conductor, is to bring all the musicians together in one concept. And mostly, I think that has to do dynamically. Because dynamically, that's where the orchestra is going to go in different directions. It's rare when a music director talks about dynamics and brings everybody together, you know. So
you talk about listening, and I've just come from observing you in a fantastic rehearsal for Stephen Bryant's new concerto. It's obvious that you're an incredible listener and are so sensitive and aware of what the others are doing in the performance, even as the soloist. Now, is that something that was developed at a very early age? I know your parents were both professional musicians. Is that true?
Yeah. Well, I think your listening skills get better. You know, they shouldn't get worse. You know, so you're working on your own playing, reading the notes, but at the same time, you have to be listening and fitting in exactly with everybody else. And, you know, when I played second trombone with Glenn Dodge and Charlie Vernon, you know, I was listening to both of those gentlemen at the same time. So that helped my skills. But even as a first trombone player, you had to listen around you all the time. You have to be very aware, especially as a trombonist, you have to be aware, because a lot of the role that we play is in a supporting way. Mm-hmm. So, you know, as much as we think we're very important, sometimes we're not. And most often we're not. So you have to, of course, you know, come together in a unified way within your own section when you're important and work as a team. But many times it's just providing a texture underneath.
Mm-hmm. What else do you see in students today that you want to encourage them to maybe think about in a different way or might help them progress faster?
Well, I have I'm working on, you know, I have all these concepts in my head, and yeah, you know, I've thought about writing a book, but I'm doing it differently. If I can just, you know, put a little plug in for this thing.
Absolutely.
It's called AlessiMusicStudios.com.
Okay.
It's something where I'm putting all my concepts down there slowly, month by month, adding new content, but it also focuses on this exact problem that we just spoke about, which is, you know, listening, knowing the piece, you know, how it goes. So we've provided an orchestral accompaniment to all the excerpts. So I've worked with a gentleman, a friend of mine, and you know, they're all high quality audio files. You know, it's not MIDI or anything like that.
Right.
It's really a nice orchestra, and so you can play with an orchestra and practice your excerpts.
Nice.
And you know, it's not just the excerpts; it's what leads up to the excerpts and what comes after it. And anyway.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, we'll have to check that out.
Sure.
What was the transition from trumpet? You said you started on trumpet, like
yes.
your father, correct?
Right.
And then what was the methodology for the transition to trombone, can I ask?
Well, I was only 8 years old when I switched. And who knows what, I mean, you know, I was getting quite good with technique and fingers and moving around the instrument, moving around the trumpet. But, you know, the high register just wasn't developed.
Mm-hmm.
And since I was progressing through all these things, I mean, the next thing was get your high register so I can, you know, play these harder solos. But I was only 8. And so I was getting frustrated doing this. So that's why sometimes it's not always a good idea to start too young.
Okay.
Because, once you progress and you're doing well, but, you know, physically, physically you're not ready.
Right.
You know, to do some of this stuff. So, anyway, I was getting frustrated, and my father could see that, and so he brought home a trombone. And he had a good idea, which is, certainly if you play the trumpet and then you play the trombone, you're going to automatically have a better high register because you're thinking in those terms.
Right.
So that's what happened, and I didn't really want to play the trombone. That wasn't on my mind at all. I wanted to do what my father did. But, you know, he kept trying, and then eventually I tried it and, you know, played in the high register, and then I was able to play even some of the difficult solos already, almost immediately on the trombone.
And you talked about, when you were chatting with the musicians of the UT Wind Ensemble on the break, mm-hmm. about how important it was, how impactful your teachers were, but also not to give up.
Mm-hmm.
I think a lot of folks can look at an amazing career like yours that seems young to me, even if it didn't seem young to you when you're all the way to the New York Philharmonic, and say, that's easy for him to say. What can you say to them?
Well, again, that's will to succeed and also enthusiasm for the love of it.
Mm-hmm.
If you love it, if you really want to do something and you love to do it, you know, I think you have to love it first. You know, so I loved it initially from the joy that I had when my father was teaching me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, even though that was difficult sometimes. But, you know, I just kept having that feeling of excitement, especially when you progress.
Right.
You know? So I think there's certain people that are just inquisitive, and they want to, they're very curious about what to do, and I think my most successful students at Juilliard have been the real curious ones, the ones who ask a lot of questions. You know, it's hard for the teacher because he's always asking a question, but I would rather have that than somebody who's just not interested.
Right.
And is kind of dead, you know, spiritually. Now, that teacher is supposed to encourage that, encourage getting the student excited, but you know, it's, and I never give up with the students either. So sometimes there's weeks and weeks and weeks or months that go on, and the student's just not into it, you know. And so, but it, sometimes you can strike, a nerve or something, and they can get ignited and get going again.
And so, I mean, we talk about you're playing three different performances this week. You have a full schedule at Juilliard, I'm sure. How do you find time to balance all that?
Well, it's a tightrope act, you know. Like, you know, and I'm not the only person who has had periods of time like that.
Sure.
All good musicians have. If you're in demand, that's what you have to deal with, you know. And you're going from one thing to the next. Now, you know, I admit that sometimes I take on too much. So, you know, I have to figure out some kind of balance there. But I think if you know you're going to do something and you're asked to do something, and let's say it's a lot of new pieces I got to learn. This is probably the most I've ever learned in this short amount of time.
Okay.
It's exciting. It's exciting to premiere new works and to have the first interpretation of something.
Well, and having
not to mention the contribution, you know, that well, I don't want to say my contribution, but I would like to say it in a way that we just need more repertoire.
If you could only say one thing to young players watching this who want to grow up to be like you, and there are many, many, many of them out there, not just on the trombone, what would you say?
Well, I would say the instrument can be like eye candy sometimes.
Okay.
Okay, so you see, oh, I want to play an instrument. And then, you know, but once you start playing that instrument, and if you love music, you know, eventually you're going to have to study how to play that instrument and do all the traditional things that have been done over the hundreds of years that people have been playing instruments, and doing your scales and, you know, working on your rhythm. And, you know, you have to, it's not just a hobby anymore.
Right.
You know, in the beginning it looks, oh, well, that guy got a trumpet, I want to get a trumpet, you know, or he got a new tuba or whatever, you know, I have to have this new tuba. Well, you know, it's not about the instrument, it's about this instrument. It's an instrument in your mind, mm-hmm. that controls that instrument. Mm-hmm. So it's very important to recognize that that you have to develop your ear and you have to be able to sing, pretty much sing everything you play. So if you can't sing it, you can't play it. The bottom line is you just have to love it. You have to love music, you have to love singing. If you don't love to sing or whistle or anything like that, okay, and you think singing is for, you know, if you think singing is embarrassing, saying,
okay,
you know, then you're in the wrong business, you know. So, you know, you have to be able to love to sing and then translate that to your instrument.
Well said.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for taking time to do this.
Thank you.
Appreciate it a lot. It's just an honor to have you here.
Yeah, thank you. And I just want to say to all the band directors, thank you for you know, for giving me the chance to you know, use the trombone, you know, and as a musical instrument, that you consider the trombone a musical instrument, and a soloist, you know, not in the orchestra world, that's not really thought of in that way.
Well, that's a shame, because it was fantastic today, and we can't wait to hear it again.
Okay, thanks.
Yes, thank you.